from the madness around me, like a child who's afraid of the dark. But when I call on Jesus, all things are possible. I can mount wings like eagles and soar. When I call on Jesus, mountains are gonna fall, 'cause you'll move heaven.
Give myself away, so you can use me. For you, and I know just what you're going through, and if you can't see what tomorrow holds, and yesterday is through, remember, I know the plans I I have for you.
Amen.
I know the plans I have for you. What you're going through, and if you can see what tomorrow holds, and yesterday is all through, remember, I know the plans I have for you to give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow. I know the plans I have for you. You see, I know just what you're going through. And if you can't see why tomorrow holds, and yesterday is all through, remember, I know the plans.
Read with me a verse, few verses of scripture that will form the basis of all we'll do today. Isaiah chapter 41, verses 13 through 15. Isaiah 41, open your Bibles and your tablets and your phones, wherever your Bible is. And we will read together. Isaiah 41, 13 through 15. We want to thank Brother Moore and the other gentlemen who came and got us at the hotel today. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you. Thank you for getting us here. Isaiah 41, 13 through 15. Can we read in unison? Everybody? All right, together. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not. I will help thee. Fear not. Thou worm Jacob, and ye men of Israel, I will help thee, saith the Lord, and thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Behold, I will make thee a new sharp threshing instrument, having teeth. Thou shalt thresh the mountains, and beat them small, and shalt make the hills as chaff. The title of my message today is How to Turn Your Mountains into Molehills. How to Turn Your Mountains into Molehills. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray this day for the empowerment of your spirit and for the evidence that we have been with you through the conviction that comes from your holy word. Somebody has come into this audience this day, into this congregation, and has been climbing a mountain all week long, weary, tired, and frustrated. Today, Father, we pray that you may bring relief to that soul and liberation through your holy word. May our hearts be lifted heavenward. May Jesus be seen as our strength, our hope, and our helper. Thank you, O God, for your promise that you will speak when we open your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Be seated, everybody. My brothers and sisters, the proverbial mountain has caused many of us major frustration. As a matter of fact, that mountain has brought tears to many eyes. That mountain has created roadblocks to our progress. The proverbial mountain has caused many to have dreams dreamt but dreams deferred. Somehow, the proverbial mountain has gotten in the way of our advancement. I want to tell you today out of God's word and teach you that our mountains were meant to be redemptive. Our mountains were meant to be purposeful in our lives. Do not discard your mountains. Don't turn away from them. They may be just what you need to get you to your destination. Amen, somebody. How to turn mountains into molehills. His name is Eric Weinmeier. And Eric Weinmeier is considered to be one of the greatest mountain climbers on the planet today. He has successfully climbed the seven major mountains in the world, from Mount McKinley to Mount Kilimanjaro to Mount Everest. A remarkable mountain climber and a remarkable achievement, especially when you stop to consider that Eric Weinmeier is totally blind. He was on the cover of Time magazine, and the caption read, "Blind Faith." Blind, but has faith to climb mountains. And when Eric Weinmeier was interviewed, he said, "The way I'm able to climb my mountains, even with my physical challenges, and the way I was able to climb the seven major summits of the world, is because, first of all, in my mind, I picture myself at the top of the mountain. And then once I picture myself at the top of the mountain, I then proceed to put myself into what I picture." You have to see a thing before you can become a thing. Where do you see yourself? He said he sees himself in his imagination on top of Mount Everest. And then I climb to get there. And then he said something that is provocative. He said, "And because there's a blind man climbing these seven major mountains," a blind man, he says, "what I have taught the world is simply how to turn mountains into molehills." And when I thought about Eric Weinmeier, Isaiah 41, 13 to 15 came to mind. We just read those verses. When God says, "Thou shalt take mountains and turn them into molehills." And this is what God is saying to Israel. And he was speaking to a specific audience. And that audience that God was speaking to through the prophet Isaiah is the Jewish people at their lowest point. And not only are they at their lowest point, but they are having their greatest challenge. They have been in exile, prisoners of war, for 70 years. And God is calling upon them after 70 years of exile to return back to their homeland and rebuild their devastated civilization. And that was a mammoth task because they were a weak people who did not have many resources. Now, to understand the mood they were in and how overwhelmed they were by the challenges of rebuilding their destroyed civilization, it would be the equivalent of gathering the people of the Ninth Ward in New Orleans, and after Katrina had devastated New Orleans, especially the Ninth Ward, and I've been there, which is poverty on steroids, telling these people to go back to the Ninth Ward and saying, build it back up. That's a mountain type order, my brothers and sisters. One woman who lived in the 9th ward after Katrina said that before Katrina, I had nothing. After Katrina, I have less than that. And God is saying to these same people who are like the displaced people after Katrina, people, I want you to go back and I want you to rebuild. That's a tall order. It's like a blind man climbing the 7 major mountain peaks in the world. It's a tall order, especially when you consider how weak these people were. In fact, what God calls them in verse 14, God says, fear thou not, worm. God called these people worms. And in the Bible, whenever a person is called a worm, you don't have anything going for you. Look at Job 25 and verse 6. It says, how much less man that is a worm? And look at Psalm 22 and verse 6. But I am a worm and not a man. You are nothing, Isaiah says. And go back to Isaiah and look at verse 14 again. It says, fear not thou worm. Now you've got nothing going for you. You've got a worm job. You've got worm education. You've got a worm house. You got worm talent. You got worm money. You live in a worm village, drive a worm car. Do I have any worms in here today? Your mama is a worm. Your daddy is a worm. You've got some worm children. You are just a worm. Ladies and gentlemen, if the story ended here, everybody would walk out of this church frustrated today. But thanks be to God, the gospel will tell you a lot about you. But the gospel will always remind you of what you can become. Amen, somebody. You are a worm, but look at what God says. Notice what God says worms are going to do. Look at verse 15 and look at how God is going to enable, empower, and equip worms. God says, look at this. Check this out. I will make thee a sharp threshing instrument having teeth. Thou shalt thresh the mountains and beat them small. You are a worm, but you're going to take the mountains and you're going to turn them into molehills. That's what worms are going to do. Do you know what a worm looks like? What you thought was overwhelming and too big for you and too challenging for you is going to be like climbing a molehill. Now, it's really a mountain, but I'm going to equip you and give you power to take down a mountain. Now, God equips worms to turn mountains into molehills. But listen to me. Instead of turning mountains into molehills, as the Word of God says, most of us make a molehill out of a mountain. No, I'm sorry. You got it, but I said it wrong. We make mountains out of a molehill. We take a bump in the road and act like it's the end of the road. We look at a bump and we become unglued with a little bump. We sit and trip over small stuff. Have you ever been around folk who fuss and fume over everything? They drive you crazy, don't they? And some of you live with some of these people. You're married to some of them. You sleep right next to some of them. We act like nobody has the problems that we have. And we face setbacks in life because we have not learned how to deal with the small things. How to not become unglued with the little things. We have not learned yet how to stop sweating the small stuff. Let me give you a little counsel. If there is something in your life that needs to be changed and you have the power to change it, go ahead and change it. But if there's something in your life that you can change, what in the world are you doing worrying about it? If I can't change it, I've got to learn to live with it. Now, I love basketball, but I am certain that the day will never come when the New York Knicks will draft me to play for them.
As much as I love it, I can't do anything about it. So the next best thing I do, I purchase a ticket and I go watch them play. If you can't change it, don't fuss about it. Don't worry about it. Learn to live with it. Say amen, somebody. But if I have the power within me to change it, go ahead and change it. Don't fuss. Now God says, I want you folk to master your mountains. And how does that happen? One of the primary ways in which people turn molehills into mountains, small stuff that shouldn't trip you up, is something into something big, is through worry. Do you know that it's not a big deal what people think about you? Amen, somebody. Listen to me. It's not a big deal what people think about you. I am 53 years old, and I've gotten to the point where it doesn't matter what you say, what you think about me, as long as you're not paying my rent, and you're not putting food on my table, and you're not paying my bills, I really don't care what you think. Listen to me. Now, some of you need to be liberated today. You do not need in any way to lose sleep over what people are saying about you. Now, my mama taught me this. She says, make certain when people talk about you that what they're saying about you is not true. Isn't that some good counsel? So if you call me a thief, and I know I'm not a thief, why am I worried about it? Amen, somebody. If you call me a liar and I'm not a liar, why am I worried about it? Amen, somebody. Now, some of us stop going to church because somebody at church talked about us. And we leave this church and we go to Midland Heights. But there are folk over there who will talk about you too. They might even talk worse about you over there because you can run, but you can't hide. Human nature is the same everywhere. And you've got to learn to deal with what comes along the path of life. Now, there's one thing worse than being talked about. And you know what that is? Not being talked about. Amen. So you don't worry about what people say about you. If people don't speak to you, what people say about you, it's not a big deal. Worry turns molehills into mountains. Anything you worry about, you are actually making a bigger problem out of it. Worry about your health and see if the problem doesn't get bigger. Worry about your finances and see if the problem doesn't get bigger. Let me tell you one sure way to get out of debt. If you are in debt right now, I could give you a biblical principle to get out of debt. Do you know what that is? Start returning a faithful tithe to God. Because God doesn't lie. He says, I will pour you out blessings that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Do you know there's only one place in the entire Bible from Genesis to Revelation where God says, put me to the test. It's right in this verse regarding tithes and offerings. God says, test me. Put me to the test. See if I will not open you some windows out of heaven and I'll pour you out some blessings that you wouldn't have room enough to receive it. Now, let me tell you this, folk, and I am serious about this. If you don't return a faithful tithe, you shouldn't be serving in God's church. Yeah. Y'all don't like it. I'm on vacation. Y'all can't do nothing about it. Yeah. You shouldn't be serving. You should resign tonight until you get your life right. The church manual says you shouldn't be serving not on a committee because you're a poor example of Christian stewardship and faith. You shouldn't be up here as an elder reading the scripture. Bring you all the tithe into the stores. I pastored a man once who would stand and says, bring you all the tithe into the storehouse and prove me now. Hear what saith the Lord of hosts. And when I checked the records, he hadn't given anything in 9 years. So I said, listen, I need to talk to you, man. I said, you need to either start right now. If you can do it, sit down until you get your life together. God says, if you worry about your finances and don't do the right thing, it will not get better, it will get worse. But if you want it to get better, just return a faithful tithe to God. And let me tell you about tithe. Returning a faithful tithe to God has very little to do with the money you bring. It has everything to do with the faith you exercise. God doesn't need your money. Amen, somebody. Ellen White says in the book Stewardship, the reason why God gave the tithing system to his people is so that our faith may be increased. It's to increase my faith in him. So when I get paid, the first person I should make certain gets what is his is God Almighty. Now, on the other hand, let me tell you how to turn something big like a mountain into a molehill. If worry turns molehills into mountains, then worship turns mountains into molehills. Now, when I say worship turns mountains into molehills, I'm not just talking about coming to church. Because you can come to church and still not worship. If you come to church here and your heart is hard, your attitude is bad, you're seeing everything that goes wrong, who's splitting the king's English, who's not singing on the right note, you're not worshiping. Amen, somebody. And by the way, I'm going to say this and I'm going to say it because I know folk listening. I'm going to tell you this. A whole lot of us believe that all worship is the time that we have the praise team singing. I'm going to tell you this. I've been worshiping the Lord long before praise team was a part of the Adventist church for many years. And a whole lot of people believe that if that's not in place, that we haven't worshiped. Worship has nothing to do with who is leading you. Worship has everything to do with the attitude of your heart. So I don't care who preaches here. If Pastor Mendes is not here and the elder is preaching, I can come here and receive a blessing because it has nothing to do with who's leading me. You can't lead me in worship. I come to worship because my heart is right with God. Say amen, somebody. And worship is an attitude toward God, not those around me. That's what we call fellowship. Fellowship goes this way. Worship goes this way. Amen, somebody. Yeah, I'm going to tell you, and I'm a part of this new model. As a matter of fact, when praise team came out in New York, I was one of the first ones that had praise teams. And the reason why I had it, I believe in a dynamic worship. I believe that worship should be joyful. You heard Pastor, joyful. Worship should be joyful. But believe me, my brothers and sisters, do not ever tell yourself this lie that I need it in order to worship my God. Because while I'm driving my car, I am worshiping. Amen, somebody. Yeah. When I say worship, I'm not talking about, all I'm really talking about is getting a good view of God. In fact, the role of worship leaders like pastors and elders and singers and praise team members and choirs, our assignment is to help you have a heightened view of God. If you don't leave here knowing that the God you serve is an awesome God, we have flunked as worship leaders. If you came here and you saw more of me than you saw of Jesus, I failed. And especially when you've come to church with a mountain. You didn't come in here to play church. I've got a mountain and I want to tell you, I want you to tell me, you worship leader, how big God is. Because when God gets large, mountains get small. Now let me show you another way we turn molehills into mountains, through fear. I don't believe that those of us who know Jesus should be scared of everything and everybody. Perfect fear. Perfect love can cast out fear. It gets rid of it. Now let me show you this. Fear. What is fear? That's projecting what might happen. Playing the what if game. A whole lot of folk are unhappy because they just believe that something is about to go wrong. But this is the day that the Lord hath made, and he will give me grace to get through this day, wouldn't he? And instead of living in fear, let me tell you what turns mountains into molehills. It is living by faith. Let me tell you that. After 9/11, I was scheduled to preach at Andrews University about two Sabbaths after that, and I called and told him, I'm not coming. I canceled that event because I was never going to get back on another plane for the rest of my life. Because I wanted to live. But you know what? The fear of dying doesn't keep you from dying. It just keeps you from living. Fear. And you can't live your life filled with fear. By the way, do you know in the Bible, God has given us 365 fear thou nots. 365 fear thou nots. Do you know why? He gave us one for every day of the year. Stop living in fear. Amen. Now, how does God help us turn mountains into molehills? Number one, we turn mountains into molehills only when we get God's perspective. Amen, somebody. I'm going to tell you, God's perspective on your problem changes everything, including the problem. Now, I fly into New York quite often, and when I fly into New York, I see all these buildings, and they look tiny to me from the air. When I land at JFK or LaGuardia, and I get in my car, and I begin driving, the same buildings that look tiny and small to me, they are huge because of my perspective. When I was 33,000 feet in the air, those same buildings looked like nothing on the ground. But when I was close to them, 7 feet away and 20 feet away and 30 yards away, those same buildings that looked like nothing now are huge in my eyes. What's the difference? My perspective. It's your perspective that sometimes determines what you're facing will either be a molehill or a mountain. Your perspective. One person facing the same thing you are facing says molehill. Another person facing the same thing who has faith says not a mountain. What's wrong? Same thing, different perspective. Now, how do I get my perspective right? Well, if you are sick, not feeling good, go to the hospital. And going to the hospital helps you get a perspective on how sick you really are. If you don't like your house, go to a shelter. Talk to somebody at the shelter. And then go back to your shotgun house that leaks. It will help you put in perspective how bad your house is. If you think all men are dogs, go to Iran. Find a husband there. It will put in perspective how bad men are here. You don't like the United States. If you live there, go someplace else and you'll come back singing, "My country, 'tis of thee." And notice God wants you, when you're facing a mountain, to get his perspective. And he says so in verse 13. He says, "For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee." I know you've got a mountain, but I don't want you to get anybody else's perspective on your situation but mine. Because folk don't always know. In fact, you got to be careful of whom you're listening to and talking to about your issues. Some of you talk too much. You tell everybody your business. Your girlfriend shouldn't know everything that's going on in your marriage. Doc, give me a little help on this mic here. I know y'all turned me down, but give me a little help. Yeah, make me feel comfortable. Thank you. Take it up a little more. I'll be happy. Yeah. Yeah, they're not going to be troubled too much. Amen. Thank you very much. Yeah, you talk too much, especially women. They've got to talk. Yeah, the woman didn't say amen. I didn't expect it. I really didn't. Yeah. You're not supposed to tell everybody everything about you. Some things are sacred. Your relationship with your husband is sacred. All your girlfriends shouldn't be hearing about your troubles. Yeah, I'm going to get to it. I'm getting there. Now, let me tell you this. Let me give you some little help. Never listen to the following people. Never receive counsel from unproductive people. How in the world somebody is going to tell you how to do something and they're not doing anything with themselves? Don't listen to unproductive people. People got to have to earn the right to speak into your life. If you're a failure, you're flunking out. Why am I listening to you? Teach your children to listen to people who have succeeded. Number two, never follow anyone who's not going anywhere. If they're not going anywhere, they already arrived. Number three, never discuss your problems with someone incapable of contributing to the solution. If you're catching the bus every day, how in the world are you going to tell me which are the best cars to drive? If your marriage is on the rocks, why am I receiving marital counseling from you? Number four, be careful where you stop to inquire for directions around the road of life. Everybody can't direct you. Number one, get God's perspective. Number two, when you're facing a mountain, acknowledge God's pattern. Because God's got a pattern. When he's taken that mountain to make it redemptive in your life, he's got a pattern. I don't know how long you've been a Christian, but I've been walking with the Lord long enough to know that God has a pattern, and here is the pattern. God always puts a problem in front of a blessing. Now, can I prove this biblically? Let's call the roll. Israel, problem, Red Sea. Blessing, promised land. Look at it. David, problem, Saul. The king wanted to kill him for 10 years. Running from the king. What's the blessing? The throne. Look at Joseph, problem, his brothers, Potiphar, and jail. But look at the blessing, prime minister of Egypt. What's Paul? Paul, what's the problem? Thorn in the flesh. Blessing, sufficient grace. Jesus, what's the problem? Mount Calvary. Blessing, resurrection on Sunday morning. And notice that the problem came and then the blessing. Now put your name there. Put your problem and then put your blessing. Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. And the reason you can't put what the blessing is because whatever you think it is, he's going to do it exceedingly abundantly above. If you already know that the blessing always comes after the problem, then you're not tripping over your problem. Because you've been with the Lord too many times and you know that the blessing is just around the corner. So folk are looking at you, and as you face your mountain, they're asking themselves, why isn't he tripping? You're acting like what you're going through is a molehill. Because you know what you're getting ready to get. That's why some of you could shout in church today and you're broke. Because you know the blessing is going to come after the problem. Amen, somebody. That's why you came to church and you just lost your job and you're still happy in God. You still got faith because you know the blessing is around the corner. The problem comes first and then the blessing. That's why you're doing the best you can with what you got, because the blessing is around the corner. That's why the devil can't trip you up anymore, because you know the problem comes right in front of the blessing. And I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Why? Because in the midst of my problems, I'm on my way to my blessings. And that's God's pattern. He just doesn't take you to a blessing without letting you go through something. He's getting you ready for the blessing, and he's getting the blessing ready for you. So he lets you go through some things. Get God's perspective. Number two, acknowledge God's pattern. And finally, access God's power. Because you see, the only reason you've got a problem is because you don't have the resources as a worm to deal with it. So if your house catches on fire, you're not going to trip if your mama's name is Oprah Winfrey. Why? What does Oprah have? She's got resources. If your tire blows out, you're not going to trip if your daddy's name is Mr. Goodyear. And if you're facing a mountain, if you really know and believe whom your father is, that he owns everything and that he's omnipotent, you will not be worried. You will not be fearful. So many of us really don't believe, but the question is today, do you believe God is what he says he is? The Bible says he's Jehovah Jireh, my provider. He's Jehovah Nissi, the Lord is my banner. He's Jehovah Rohi, he's my shepherd. He's Jehovah Tsidkenu, he's my righteousness. He's Jehovah Shalom, he's my peace. He's Jehovah Rapha, he's my healer. He's Jehovah Mekadosishim, he's my sanctifier. He's Jehovah Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts. He's Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is here. He's our provider. That means that when I don't have the resources, my father is rich in houses and lands. And if I love him and worship him and do his will, he will open a door and make a way. Now, he may not come when I want him to come, but he'll be there when this worm needs him. Say amen, somebody. In fact, look at what he says in verse 13. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. I lost my job, but what did God say? I'll help you. Things are not going the way I want them to go. But what did God say? I'm going to help you. Fear thou not, I'll help thee. I've got trouble every way and on every side. But what did God say? He says, fear not, I will help you. I got a bad medical report. But what did God say? Fear not, I'm going to help you. I'm getting a little bit old and my steps are not what they used to be. But what did God say? He says, fear not, I will help you.
Folk will not be there for you, but what did God say? He says, fear not, I'm going to help you. And just in case you didn't get it the first time, he's going to repeat it himself again in the next verse. Verse 14, he says, fear thou not, worm Jacob, and ye men of Israel, I will help you.
And the way he helps you is two ways. He'll help you by first giving you a hand. Look at this verse again. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help you. Your right hand is where your strength is. That's your gifted hand. And God is saying, I'm going to help you in the area where you're gifted. Now, many of us are wondering why the Lord is not helping us. And that's because we are trying to do something that we are not gifted to do. But if you find what the Lord has called you to do, he will help you. Now, I have been offended by the fact that my church has never asked me once in 8 years to sing the solo part when the choir sings. Yeah, I've been offended by that. But you know what? They got good sense. They know it's not my gift. Amen, somebody.
And God will help you by holding your right hand in the area of your giftedness.
And most of us want to do what is not in our area of giftedness. But God says, if you find what your gift is, I'm going to help you. God doesn't want you climbing other people's mountains. I can't climb that mountain. That's because that mountain wasn't for me. But once you find your Mount Everest, once you find what God wants you to do, see if he will not help you.
And then not only will he give you a hand, but the Bible says he'll also give you a heart. Look at verse 15. Behold, I will make thee a new sharp threshing instrument having teeth.
I'm a worm, but I've got a bite like a Rockweiler. And can I tell you what happens when God gives you teeth? Do you know why animals have teeth? Not only to gnash stuff, but also to hold on to something. And God wants you to hold on to your dreams and not let go. And I don't care if a devil or a demon is messing with you. You hold on to what God told you to hold on to. He says, I'm going to give you teeth. I will help you.
Now, talking about blindness, there was a man whose car got stuck in the ditch out in the country. And a farmer came by and said, I can help you. I've got a horse named Dusty, but Dusty is a blind horse. But he's a strong horse. And I'll get Dusty to pull your car out of the ditch. So he hooked Dusty up to the car and then he said, pull Gertrude. Then he said, pull Molly. And then he said, pull Dusty. And Dusty pulled the car out of the ditch.
And the man looked at the farmer and says, "Thank you, sir, but I've got one question. Why did you call Gertrude and why did you call Molly?" And the farmer said, "Because you see, Dusty is strong, but Dusty is blind. And as a blind horse, if Dusty ever thought that he was pulling by himself, he would have quit. So Dusty had to know somebody was pulling with him." You know what, my brothers and sisters, you will quit if you don't know that God is pulling with you. But when you know that you've got God on your side and God says, "Don't worry about it, I'm gonna pull with you," you will be able to face your mountain. And the Bible says you will thrash the mountain like the valley. Because if God be for you, who in the world can be against you? And greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And I've got my mind made up that I'm going to trust him daily. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Behold, he says, you shall make the mountain a shaft. Whatever your mountains are today, God's promises, my brother and sister, that he'll help you with it. Yeah, God's promise is, whatever you're facing, he'll face it with you. Whatever issues you are contending with, God says to each of us today, "I'm going to contend with you. I'll fight this battle with you. I'll help you bring this mountain down. I am here to help you. I'll help you. I will help you. You do not have to fight alone. You're just a worm. But I'm going to put some teeth inside of that worm, and I'm going to help you bring your mountain down." Whatever your mountains are, whatever mountains you're climbing today, I can assure you, based upon the word of God, that you don't have to climb it alone. I can guarantee you that God, who made this promise in the book of Isaiah, will keep his word. For whatever God says he'll do it. His promises are sure. His word is certain. And God's got Holy Ghost power to give to every believer. Whatever your mountain, whatever your issue, whatever your circumstance, whatever your battle, whatever the fight is today, by the grace of God, you will be able to make it if you yoke up with Christ, become a partner with him. Somebody needs to release something to God today. This is a message of liberation. In other words, somebody can leave this church today liberated and free of worry, free of fear, and your mountain can become a molehill if you do it God's way. He wants you, each believer, not only today, but for the rest of your days, to cast worry aside. He wants you to not live in a lane of fear and depression. He wants to liberate you, make you free. He wants to give you victory today. Everybody stand to your feet, because we're going to have a prayer today that will include each of you who decides, by the grace of God, to find liberation through asking God to be your helper. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. Somebody here wants to say, "Pastor, I've got a mountain, got something I'm facing. I need wisdom. I need God's help." God's help is right now being dispensed to each believer. He'll give you wisdom, but he'll give you the fortitude. He'll give you Holy Ghost power to experience victory. In this moment, there's somebody right now who wants to say, "Pastor, I want you to pray for me, that God will help me with my mountains." If that's your desire, I want you to raise your hand, put it down. I see all those hands. Somebody's got a mountain. God bless you. We'll pray for that. There's somebody else who wants to say, "Pastor, I've never accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. Or maybe I need to come back home. And I want you to pray for me today, Pastor, that I will yoke up with Christ, who is the great author and finisher of our faith, the one who will walk beside me and be my traveling companion." If that's my desire, if that's your desire, I want you
Raise your hand. Say, I want to accept Jesus as my Savior and my Lord today. God bless you to the back. There's somebody else. Somebody else in the balcony, ground floor. Somebody say yes to Christ today. Yes to Christ today.